Now here's how we act. Here is what we do. You always start with who God is and who He has made you to be before you start trying to do stuff. If you try to do stuff before you understand all that, you will burn out and you will crash in flames. That's not a good place to be as a disciple. We must be full of the Spirit and understand the gospel. Okay? You with me right there, everybody?
Or stuff, but my mama got to come get me in school. You know what I mean? What?
you to, amen, right now, I want to encourage everybody, would you? He says, Christ appointed it, when he ascended on high, he left baptism in his strength and gave gifts to men. When you were baptized, before you were born, God gifted you with a gift set, and he's got a ministry. He said, you are in his workmanship, and you're created in Christ Jesus to do good works. He's got a work for you to do. And when you find what that is, as it says in the Hebrew, your wheelhouse, if you find that, you got to go. show up in fellowship.
Oh, what?
They give you a big old hug? You just feel the power come into you. It's just something that can light you up with a smile. I mean, my wife is that way. She just smiles. I'm just like, that's why not Jerry and I are having a conversation with you. They don't look at me.
I go, I lean over, and I radar lock them. I say, I'll come back, stay with me.
But still, for us, after she's smiling, I don't even look at old friend and face me. I still got a Bible I can teach you. Maybe I know that. I'm saying people have their, other gifts, though. They're artistic gifts, writing gifts. So we need people to write. We need people to write breaks. We need people to do this theater stuff up here. Let me tell you, it's high impact. We just got a taste of it. We used to do the final church of one God. We used to think we used to play. Pay about $18 a ticket to come watch our Christmas show. We sold out 7 a year. People pay to come to church. I found a new evangelistic ticket. Charge people to come. Yeah. Pack the club. People came to see the show we did called Love Christmas Spirit. We put 200 of our members to work. Some were acting, some were ushering. But it was awesome. Music, singing, and acting. And people, Archie people need their shout. If we don't, they can go out in the world and trash their lives doing something crazy. We got to use them in the church where it's righteous and pure and good. You know what I'm saying? Writing, athletics. Yes, we do need people like that. Organization, administration, mathematics, science, computers. Praise God for you guys. Mechanical, sewing, cooking. We need everybody. You're gifted. How can you discover who you should get? I'll give you 4 quick points. It says, one, your gift is something you're good at and you quickly improve at it. You're good at it and you get better rapidly. That's a gift. Secondly, others comment when you exercise your gift. Yeah, that was cool. That was awesome. Can you do that again? The people said, please sit down. Didn't you know? Well, you got a lot to learn. Maybe you didn't. Now, the first time I preached, I couldn't find Romans 8:31, so I thought that wasn't my gift, but I had to be patient. Okay. Thirdly, spiritual leaders affirm that it's your gift and put you to work in the church with you. So, brothers and sisters that are leaders, we need to learn to spot, pull the gifts out of all the members of the church. You know what I'm saying? That's my admonition to you. And fourthly, when you use your gift, you are fulfilled and you feel close to God. When you use it in service to God, not use your gift selfishly, take you away from God. But if you use your gift in service to God, you feel great about it. And if you have this feeling inside, it's what God wants you to feel when it's his job well done. That's your gift. Okay, let's go to some new standards. Verse 17. Okay, it's time to start dealing with junk in our life. Here we go. Just because we're saved by grace doesn't mean we don't need to get the sin out of our life. Just because we've been baptized in Christ and received in Christ doesn't mean we don't get tempted. We don't have the old person still alive inside of us trying to come back on. What is this? When someone says, you know, we take up our cross, we follow Christ, we put our life on the altar, and lay it up there for God. Problem with a living sacrifice? It's always trying to crawl off the altar. We took up our cross. Sometimes we want to drop that thing, don't we? We say, and yet we know in our heart of hearts that to lose our life is to gain it. To follow Jesus is the greatest, most noble thing we can ever do. But there are times when it's difficult. And then some of that is when sin comes back into our life. I would encourage you to know this, that just because you're baptized in Christ doesn't mean your old nature will come back and tempt you. Don't let Satan tell you you're not a true Christian. Don't let him tell you you're not for real. That's what he tried to tell Jesus when he was hanging on the cross. If you are the Son of God, come down off that cross. Just because you're going through challenges doesn't mean you're not a son or daughter of God. It just means you're going through challenges and Satan's in your face. That's what that means. And so what do you have to do? All right, this is verse 17. I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that's in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they've given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity with a continual lust for more. That's our own life. What is it? Hardness of heart. Ignorance and darkness of mind starts in the heart when we turn away from God. Then it affects the way we think. Then we are separated from God. Then we have a loss of sensitivity. And we start doing stuff that we never thought we would do. How did that? The prodigal son never thought he'd end up in that pit. That's not what he said. He loaded up the beamer and headed out of the park. But that's where he ended up. It's never our intention. You know, sin is shaking hands with an octopus. You know, hey, how you doing? You know, and you are now stuck. We think, I'm cool enough to get close to sin, into sin, and just walk away when I feel like it. No, you ain't. Excuse me, it's other than over and increasing degradation, then it gets worse. Well, I'll sin some, but it won't really affect my character. It won't really hurt me. I won't get worse. I'll just pull out. It will get you and pull you every which way, but loose that southern identity will beat you up. It'll mess you up, take away stuff, take away who you really are. Sin steals who you really are. Sin is not your true self. Sin is not the real you. The truest you is what created in the image of God, this awesome person. Sin, yeah, you say, well, I'm really genuinely tempted inside of sin. Yeah, but that's the you that God made you to be. That's just sin getting a hold of you and working your passions. Passion is a good thing when directed towards God and others in a righteous way. Passion is directed towards self and for selfish indulgence. Drags you down. He says, therefore, he gives you up. He says, but you, however, verse 20, did not come to know Christ that way. Surely you heard of him and were taught in him in accordance with the truth. It's in Jesus. Now, I want you to notice that. He's reminding them of their conversion here. You with me? If you look down south, you realize there's a lot of religion and a lot of teaching about getting right with God. And every time the name of Jesus is lifted up and people are challenged to believe in Christ, we ought to be grateful. Amen. But the real neglect and so much teaching are in the religious world is the issue of repentance. A lot of folks want to be saved. It's just that lordship part that bothers me. I would really like to be saved, but can I get Jesus at bargain basement? You know, maybe the blue light special shoppers, maybe they can go on sale. I mean, I'm going to search the internet and find a cheaper version here where I don't have to make Jesus Lord. Just say, unfortunately, that kind of stuff goes around. We think, well, okay, quickly you can accept Christ as Savior. When you become a Christian, maybe later on, years later, you figure out you need to repent. No, that comes with it. I'm not saying that kind of stuff that you won't be changing 10 years down the road, learning more about repentance 10 years down the road, right? But the basic thing we got to know is, I'm giving my life to God. I'm surrendering myself. I'm turning over ownership. Is Jesus taking the wheel time? I'm turning loose.
Ooh, I'm letting go, and I am letting Jesus run my life.
Amen.
That we must know. Jesus said, unless you repent, you will perish.
Amen.
Repent and be baptized. Not like get saved and, oh, later, yeah, I get baptized. Oh, yeah, later, repent. I'm just saying, that's the way Jesus set it up. We got to understand it. He said, you did not come to know Christ that way. You heard of him and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that's in Jesus. You were taught to the guard your former way of life. Put off your old self. You have an old self. It's surrendered to sin. Get rid of it. It's being corrupted by its deceitful desires. Be made new in the attitude of your mind. Let me tell you something. The large part of the battle to be a Christian is fought not just in your heart, but in your head. Between your ears is what you think. A lot of us think everything's a heart problem. Sometimes it's a thinking problem. Yeah. Your heart's not good. Maybe your heart is, but you just fill in your head with all kind of stupid thinking. You got to read your Bible. You got to pray. You got to begin to think better thoughts. Get off the crummy videos and all the junk you're reading and what kind of movies you're watching. Fill your mind with good stuff and you will feel better. You will live better. You will act better. Your heart will be better. It's between our ears, not here. It's here that we're losing. So fill your mind up with God's Word. That's why we have quiet times and pray. To do that, he said, you got to really think in your attitude around. Put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. I'm going to go through just very rapidly here and we're going to summarize it for you. Several areas. He gives some examples. It's like he says, you got to put off this and put on this. And you keep doing that as long as you're a Christian. It's like taking off dirty, old, raggedy, ugly clothes and really getting in some really spiffy new duds that you really look good. That's just dress up the way God wants you to dress up. Get rid of that junky old stuff you used to wear. For some of us, that was literal. For some of us, it's really, though, it's talking about your spiritual clothing. Get rid of this, put on this. Some of us spend all our time playing defense. We're just trying not to sin. Let me tell you what, if the Mavericks had just stood on their half of the court and tried to stop LeBron and Laing and all those dudes from scoring, they would have been 150-2, you know, nothing. I mean, you've got to play offense. You've got to have defense, but you've got to play offense. And all you're doing is waiting for where Satan's coming next. You've got to play defense, and then you get the ball, and you go put some great things in your life.
Yeah.
You with me right there? It's in Matthew 12, 43-ish, where it says some of us have demons cast out, and that demon goes flying around.
Yeah.
Because they're really nervous and they got stuff to do and they're trying to find another place to live. And they come back to your house. They say, you had the makeup. It's all clean. Hey, y'all, you know, whatever your name is, seven of us, they got the place all clean. Let's move in and make this person worse than they were before. That's why Christians have to begin to fill their life up with Bible study, fellowship, sharing our faith, loving one another, serving in the church. Then Satan just can't get in your house. You see what I'm talking to y'all this morning? You've got to get this. Otherwise, you're just trying to guard the door all the time. Fill your house up with the great things of God. When you go home from here, fill the things. Let me just say something. He's got something planned for you while you're riding up I-85 today. I have no idea what it is. You be ready for it. It's coming. You keep good things in your heart. Quickly deal with whatever fiery missile is coming to you after this conference. It was still real. Conference is still true. In spite of you, were maybe smelling the sulfur of hell by 3:00 this afternoon.
Wow.
Doesn't mean that you're in hell. Doesn't mean you got to go there. It just means that Satan ticked off at how great you're doing spiritually right now. Okay. It's not in my notes, but I just felt I needed to say that. Okay. We're gonna finish. There were six things he actually mentioned that needs to change. Just quickly, and David, you may have those on the thing. You don't put off. He mentioned several things that we need to get rid of. He talks about getting rid. I can't find it in my notes. Okay, don't tell lies. Tell the truth. Don't lose your temper or brood. Get rid of your anger every day. Don't go to bed mad. Get it right before God. You go to bed ticked off. You wake up ticked off. You got a little bit more than you were before you went to sleep. You may not sleep. Don't steal. You go get a job and give to other people. Don't use your mouth for evil. Instead, encourage people. Don't be unkind and forgiving, but be kind and loving. Don't think about sexual sin or even joke about it, but be thankful for what God has given you in Christ. That's what he says. There's some things we shouldn't even be joking about. You know, let me just say a little bit about humor. I try to use humor in preaching and all that, and we need to be humorous in the things we talk about. We have to be careful with humor so we don't cross a line of sensuality or sex or hurting people's feelings. We got to watch. Humor needs to be righteous and good. You know, I just say that, and you got the rest of your life to figure out how to do it. I'm just saying that's a good thing to know. I want to talk about new relationships, except to say in chapters 5 and 6 that marriage is in trouble. And if Jesus is Lord of two people's lives and stays Lord of two people's lives, we're going to have a great marriage.
Right.
Some of you are raising homes from divorce and separation and anger and bitterness and all kind of that, stuff like that. You have a chance to turn around your lineage and your family.
That's right.
And to find a young man or young woman that loves God with all their heart. You want to marry somebody that makes you love God more.
Yeah.
You want to marry somebody that makes you want to be more a part of the church.
Yeah.
To make somebody that wants you to be more into the Word of God. That makes you a better person. I'm a better person around my wife. I love God more and love Jesus more and care more and just become a better man. And I think she would say the same from her relationship. That's the kind of person you're looking for. You with me, right? That's chapter 5 and 6, and learn how to raise your kids and all that. We're going into the last part, which is really, really awesome. This is spiritual warfare. Look in chapter 6, verse 10. We are at war. And Paul says, finally. He does this in several of his letters. Here's the little term, finally. He does it 2 times in Philippians, once in 2 Thessalonians, once in Galatians 6:27. Finally, and as I finish, be strong in the Lord. This is an admonition for all of us today. For all we've heard about how awesome the gospel is, be strong. That's something technological that's trying to deal with me. Okay. So you can take your stand against the devil's scheme. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood, against the rulers, the authorities, the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God. It's not enough to go fight. You've got to suit up. And Paul is presently chained to a Roman soldier. How'd you like to be that guy? Oh, hey there, Quintilius. So, you chained a little old-timey Jewish guy here. You think you're pretty awesome. Well, have you ever heard about Jesus? I had to go. You can't leave. I'm going to talk to you about the Lord here. I mean, you are done for. You said there's saints in Caesar's household. You know what I think? This is just my interpretation. Remember the guys that wore the black suits in Gladiator? The Praetorian Guard that did all the certain thing? You got to remember those guys. That's the crack Delta Force Special Ops team that guarded Caesar and Rome. And Paul says Caesar's household, I think he converted. That's probably who he was changed to, one of those dudes in the black suit. I think he baptized a few of those guys. That's just my opinion. Okay, let's go. I want you to look at the next clip. You know this clip. You know you've seen this movie. But I want you to look at the armor. Look at the armor. Okay? Let's look through the list of the armor. He says, we got to be strong in the Lord. But it's not just you being strong. You've got to have some equipment that strengthens you. And I wanted you to see this because this is what Paul saw. And he's sitting there next to this guy, chained to this guy, and he's writing this letter. He said, okay, now, how can I use this for my sermon here, for my letter? That's what preachers do that a lot. But he says, our struggle, first of all, is not against flesh and blood. Our warfare is not political. We're not out to conquer some country. We're not out to change the politics everywhere or whatever. That's not our... If you want to be involved in that, that's one thing. But that's the primary warfare we're in, is a spiritual battle to save souls and keep people saved. That's our goal. And he says, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, the authorities, the powers of this dark world, and the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. You saw that, those two armies fighting each other. Let me tell you, the warfare against you, the enemy is far more intimidating, far more evil, far smarter. Why? He says, put it on so that you can stand firm against the devil's schemes. He has got a plan. Sometimes it's a direct frontal assault like this on your life. Sometimes it's like, hey, let's go get drunk, let's do drugs. You know, like Joseph and the woman back in Genesis, come to bed with me. Sometimes it's that blunt. Sometimes it's very subtle. It's pride. It's sin. It's begin to compromise here, your commitment here. Begin to miss Wednesday night. Begin to do this. Begin to kind of check the internet out a little bit on some porn you can get into. Mess around with your girlfriend a little bit, your boyfriend. Kind of stay up a little late. Get in the apartment. Which way are I? Before long, you are down in this. It can be very subtle. It can be an attitude you get against somebody in the church. You don't solve it. It's a bitter root that grows and poison in your heart. You've got to deal with it. You got to deal with it. It really eats you alive. I've seen bitterness take more people out of the church than sexual sin. You know what I'm saying? I've seen compromise with money take more people out of the church than just about anything. And just wanting to live our own life and live an easy life. That takes people out. It can be direct. It can be subtle. It can be a lot of ways. But he says, you've got to stand. You know, we're in Christ and we sit with Christ. And then we walk with Christ. But what's the last thing he says? You must stand with Christ. Stand. And he says, stand. And he has... the incredible list of armor here. He talks about the belt of truth. You didn't see the belt, but the soldiers, everything that they had on was held up underneath them by a belt that went around. They hooked everything on that. You start out with the truth of God's word. Your doctrine needs to be right, and your own life needs to be living up to it. That's the truth. Then the breastplate of righteousness, that's what covers your vital organs, your chest, your lungs, your heart, your abdomen. And the Roman soldiers would have these with beautiful. It was gorgeous. They weren't so much in this movie, but you'll see them sometimes in history that they'll have incredible scenes on this. And what is that protecting? It's the righteousness. What you live your life as a righteous person protects your inner self, your inner woman, your inner man. Thirdly, your feet shod with the gospel of peace. None of these guys were barefooted out there. A lot of us aren't sharing our faith. We're not on the advance. We're kind of sitting around, you know, barefooted in the church. Hey, let's get our shoes on, and how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news, the Bible says. Get out and advance, and you will get the excitement of being a Christian back in your life. Number four, the shield of faith. I don't know if you noticed those shields. They had some little round ones, but they were bent, side, concave like this. They had a huge boss in the middle, a metal thing. And they're about a hand width thick with two layers of wood. And they are designed to take those fiery darts. Now, the Germans didn't have their arrows lit on fire. Remember that in it's the Far Side? The American Indians were shooting at the cowboys, and their arrows on fire. They said, their arrows on fire.
Can they do that?
Yes, they can! Yes, they can. Some of you aren't as weird enough to read the Far Side as back in the 80s. 80s were a good decade. Those darts would come, and they will hit you on that shield. And they are on fire when they hit. I'm saying, the battle is clean, it's not clean, it's dirty, it's hard, it's tough. You will smell the smoke, you will hear the screams. It is tough, it is challenging, but it's the only way to live, man. You gotta get out and get in the fight. And so those arrows struck right in there. Your faith is gonna take the most hits of anything in the army. You just gotta keep trusting God. Sometimes we get our helmet off and say, I'm safe, God, bang, I'm gonna beat somebody to death. Well, I'm righteous, I'm gonna pound them. I'm just gonna keep talking about the gospel until this person gives up. You know, the shield takes most of the pressure of the battle. And you gotta have it in your life, and that's where you gotta stay strong in your faith. And then it says the sword of the Spirit. The only real offensive weapon they had was their sword. And that's your Bible, that's knowing your Bible. You know, I hope that this exposition time has helped you to fall in love more with your Bible and realize just how useful your Bible is. And you'll be praying as you study and read your Bible that God will give you those 3D moments where it comes alive. And you'll keep being a diligent Bible student in here until you realize, man, I just love this book and it's meeting the needs of my life every day. And of course, our final power source is the power of prayer. He says, and above all, verse 18, there's four alls in this verse. Pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep praying for all the saints. If you just pray some of the time, and for some people, and sometimes you're alert and sometimes you're not, then you're in trouble out there on that battlefield. Prayer is the secret source of power for every disciple. You got to pray. You got to be trusting in the Holy Spirit of God. That's it.
Go on.
We're going to close out by going back to chapter 3 and reading that together just a little bit, and I'll close with these thoughts this morning. Paul's prayer is that in chapter 3, verses 14 through 20, is that we will understand how much Jesus loves us. Someone once asked a great theologian, they said, what's the greatest, at the end of his life, he studied for years and knew so much. They said, what's the greatest lesson you've ever learned from your studies of the Bible? And he thought, and he thought. And he said, I know what it is. Yes. He said, Jesus loves me. This I know.
It's funny.
Or the Bible tells me so.
It's
the greatest lesson you'll ever learn. It's just, you know it now, but you know you got a lifetime to know how much He loves you. You know, God's our Father. And I had a tough relationship with my own dad. He died when I was 12. He had a kind of a bad temper, so it's hard for me sometimes to relate to God with that. I have to change my thinking to be like the God of this book. But I had a great big brother. I just loved him. I'd hang out with him wherever he went. He was awesome. He could do anything. Beat me in badminton, all the heavy duty. He just was incredible. We got a great big brother. He went to the cross for you. He loved it. And he'll, if you struggle with your relationship with your father, he said, you come here, little brother, little sister, I'll take you and we'll go talk to daddy. You know, that may sound a little bit goofy to you, but let me tell you something. It's awesome. We got our big brother. He loves us wider, deeper, longer, and higher. And over how much we think we know, Paul says, really, you can't ever know how much he loves you. You can't. He said it surpasses knowledge. And so, his prayer is this. To God, in verse 20, who is able, he's sevenfold, able to do all, able to do all we ask, able to do all we ask or imagine,
able to do more than all we ask or imagine, and able to do, number seven, immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. And God said, the church said to God,